Yeah. Okay. So my name is Uli Ender, and this year I will talk about my solar installations on my balcony. This is maybe the biggest project I ever made, and also it started already in 1991 when I bought a panel and connected it to a lead accumulator. If you want to contact me, here down there is my email address, uli@esperantomuenchen.de. And now I want first... Oh, yeah, maybe it's... You can also speak to me in German or English. Yeah, maybe... At the beginning, a warning, because I designed some circuit diagrams and some software also, so maybe there are still some errors in it, so be always aware when you want to use my talk in your projects. Maybe you can contact me, yes, before. So, but now into the matter. Here are two views of my solar installation on the balcony. I live in the third floor in central of Munich, and so this is from the balcony from inside my room. So you see the three panels. These are relatively new. I bought them in 2015, and this one I already bought in 1991. And this is from downstairs, from the outside, the two new panels and the old panel on the fire ladder. It is, maybe I show you that. It is oriented to the southeast, and so in the winter, sun begins to rise here, goes up there, and here's a building that will shadow the sun, and only in the late afternoon then the sun is behind the building, and I have sun again. And in the summer, then this, the next balcony, the floor of the next balcony above me, will also shadow the sun, because the sun is then very high, but it won't go into the balcony. And when you have diagrams now about how the when we have a day when sun is shining all the day in the winter, when the, for example, the 23rd of December, so when it's the shortest day, then this building will really shadow during 2 hours or so, then only a little peak is over there. The best sun conditions I have when the day and the night is equal long, so this is this here, and then the midsummer. This was on 26th of July. Then here at 11:30 or so, then the sun is so high that the balcony will shadow partly the sun, and so also I don't have the optimum sun conditions. And then, of course, in the night, sun don't shine, and even when there's a rainy day in winter, for example, then there's no sun, and it's absolutely no energy that I can get. And the other extreme is that when there is a very cold weather, but suddenly the sky is bright blue, then I get a maximum, because the efficiency of the solar cell is the best when it is cold and when the light intensity is very high. So as I have here said, that normally my three modules each has 20 watts, so it should be 60 watts in total. I never reached that, and normally what the industry says is normally really under conditions that never appear in reality, because it's only when the solar panel is cold and when the light is really in... senkrecht, so like in this direction, not in a flat angle, so you never get that. So what do I do with it? I have lamps here for mercury steam lamp or so on. Yes, and this is a LED lamp. I have various tablets, PCs is over here. I have a smartphone. I have a laptop. I have a television, radio also. And maybe the most consuming parts I can use with my solar installation is a soldering iron and a glue stick pistol when I construct something. And I have converters because the battery of the solar installation makes 12 volts, or so it is between 10.6 volts to 14.4 volts. I have a converter from 12 volt to 220 volts for the television because it operates only with 220 volts. And for the smartphones and tablets and so on, I need 5 volts, and I have a DC-DC converter that converts from 12 volt to 5 volts. And that's what I use. So I don't use a vacuum cleaner, that's too much. I don't use an electrical oven and no washing machine. This washing machine is in the house with a, I have to put coins into it. And so all the high consuming electronics I cannot use with it. And here you see the general circuit of the whole thing. Also the light is converted here to a voltage. This flows into through a fuse into the battery and charges it. And to avoid that at night or when the three modules are partly shadowed, that there's a reverse current, there are these diodes who inhibit that the current is in the other direction. And then when I have when the battery is fully loaded, I have a shunt electronic that will shortcut the battery so that the voltage, when it is above 14.4 volts, it will shortcut and the voltage will drop maybe to 14 volts and then the switch is opened again and so on. So this will reduce the voltage in the battery. I have to do that sometimes when the battery is completely charged. And then, of course, I have several consumers. For example, the lamps, they are not continuously on. Only when I want them, I switch it on and off. But I have also some consumers. They are constantly on. These are the DC-DC converters and the automatic responder of the landline telephone and the solar electronics, what I'm talking about next. And this one thing is also very important. This is a fuse that because when you shortcut a lead accumulator, it can have maybe 500 amperes times 12 volt. This is 6 kilowatts. And when you put 6 kilowatts on a copper line, then the copper will melt. And so this is really necessary to have a fuse here. So maybe I have to go back to measure the voltage and the current in and current out. I use 4 resistors. And for current in, it is between the analog ground here and the minus pole of the battery. This voltage drop multiplied by the ohmic resistor gives me the current in. And here, between these points, I can measure the current out. And here, with this resistor, compared to the combination of the two resistors, so this is 10 kilo ohms. No, it is 210 kilo-ohms divided by 10 is the multiplication factor, the theoretical. So the voltage I measure here multiplied by 210 divided by 10 is the voltage of the battery. And in first time when I had this solar installation, I only measured the voltages and voltage drops with a multimeter. But nowadays I have a solar electronic constructed. I constructed it maybe last December. That's how it looks like. It's maybe a bit confusing, but I have here these four resistors for voltage, current in, current out, and here this is the resistor to measure the voltage, and this here is the resistor that is a second resistor. And these voltages, they are put into the analog digital converter. The analog digital converter is controlled by a microcontroller here. The microcontroller takes the voltages or the measurements, puts it in between into a little memory, 8K memory, and every time at midnight, the microcontroller switches my Raspberry Pi on. Raspberry Pi has a connection to the memory chip and then sends through a Wi-Fi to the Huawei mobile Wi-Fi, and this sends it then to a Dropbox in the internet. And before I come to the general circuit, I must maybe explain why I use a microcontroller. And this is so because the Raspberry Pi and this Huawei mobile Wi-Fi would have always a power of 3 watts, and this makes an energy during the whole year of 26 kilowatt hours. But my little solar installation only gives 20 to 25 kilowatt hours. So I cannot, it makes no sense to use it. I could, of course, use the Raspberry Pi with the normal mains, but then maybe you would say, why do you do that? Yeah, and so I use now the Raspberry Pi only for 2 minutes per day at midnight. It's sufficient to transfer the data to the internet. And during the whole day, I have this ATtiny85, which is operated only by 128 kilohertz, and the analog digital converter and the memory chip and a 5-volt DC-DC converter. This makes only 0.019 watts, so nearly nothing. So in total, I have maybe 0.25 kilowatt hours per year consumption instead of 26. So it is a factor 1,000 less. So okay, now you see maybe finally the schema of the whole apparatus. So the analog digital converter takes by these resistors the voltage drops, and the microcontroller through an I2C bus takes every 0.47 seconds the data and adds the data. After 2 minutes, I have 256 sums of the data, and this makes digitally an 8-bit shift. So the resulting, the highest 2 bytes are then the mean value of the 256 measurements. So, and this then gives, as the analog digital converter has a 16-bit accuracy, voltage, current in, current out, each have 2 bytes, so I have 6 bytes within 2 minutes. I add also an individual number to find out what happened when. and this is stored in the 8K memory. So after 24 hours, I have 720 records of this measurements, and then the microcontroller switches the Raspberry on and the mobile hotspot on, connects also to a second I2C bus, and then sends the data to the Dropbox cloud. And then it is there in my cloud, and I can, with any of my computer that have access to the Dropbox cloud, I can take the data and make a visualization of the data. So you can imagine that there's a lot of tickle involved in all these steps. For example, there was writing an assembler for the ATtiny and writing an SDA SPI interface for the Raspberry Pi. By this SPI bus I sent, this is a typing error. And I have to, here I wrote it, SPI interface. I don't want to talk about this now. Maybe later in the coffee break I will make a little demonstration about programming and assembling it. Okay, and then I load data from memory chip to a Raspberry Pi via I2C bus. This I already mentioned in the last talk of last year. And next thing which I can show you is sending and receiving data through the Dropbox uploader from Andrea Fabrizi. Finally, cannot be seen, but I wrote a little integrated development environment for this project, and I did also the visualization of the whole thing. And now maybe I go a bit in detail what every midnight, what the Raspberry Pi does when it is switched on. Also, it is switched on, and then the Raspberry Pi runs a script. This is called Einmal, because it runs it only once per day. And so it does initialization of the I2C bus, then copying the content of the memory chip to a file that is called Speicherdump text. And meanwhile, the Raspberry Pi maybe is on during 1 minute. And now the connection to the internet is established, and then I can get I can get the time from the internet. I do that relatively late, because when the Raspberry Pi is freshly started, it has no connection to the internet. Then I have a file Zähler text. This is a individual file number that is incremented every day to have every day an individual file. And this individual file is then the time of the day, the solar data, and the name of the file has then the new file number that is taken from this counter. So one of the last steps is then to calculate and store a parameter record to the memory locations 0 to 7. This is a kind of feedback for the microcontroller, how he has exactly behaved for the next day. And then we have the Dropbox uploader. The data file is sent to the Dropbox. Then after 2 minutes, the Raspberry Pi is switched off, and the controller reads and processes the new parameter record. So some words about the Dropbox uploader. This is a bash script from Andrea Fabrizi in Italy. And you can download an installation file. When you run it, then you have to get a secret number from the Dropbox. You have to have an account from Dropbox. And this secret number is then stored in a hidden file, so .dropbox uploader script or something like that. This must always be accompanied with your Dropbox uploader script to have the authorization to access to the Dropbox. And then I only use the data file in this way that I execute the at home p is the is my home directory in the Raspberry file. Then Dropbox uploader is the subdirectory where the script is. The script is Dropbox uploader shell. And the command is upload, to upload a file. And there you must say which file. This is homep.py394.txt. And in the Dropbox directory, then I take the same name, .py395.txt, yes. So now I have the file here in. And here you have maybe a look how the file is constructed. Also, it begins with the time of the last record that was sent to the memory chip. This was, for example, the Tuesday, June 6, 22 o'clock. This is in Greenwich Mean Time, but in summertime, so it is a difference of 2 hours. So this would be midnight and 4 minutes in Middle European time. And then there's a parameter record. This has 8 bytes. 2 bytes is the coarse and the fine adjustment of the timer of the memory of the microcontroller, because the microcontroller doesn't have a quartz time. It has not enough pins to add a quartz, so it uses the internal RC oscillator, and this has is very imprecise. So sometimes it varies from day to day by 4 minutes or so. So we have with this adjustment, you can. So if the number is higher, the timer is faster. Or if it is slower, then timer is slower. You can adjust individual the timer to have a 2 minute delay between the two records always. And then there is a starting number and a number of 2 minutes records that are stored in the chip. And afterwards, when the data is in the chip, I can find the start and the end of the data by finding this number. For example, the first data is no time left. Also, and you find this is the number of start, then you add 207 to it. 16 plus 7 is 18. 5 plus 207 is 212. No? This is the end record. So all the data records here are the actual data records of the day. And this is then the voltage in binary, the current in and the current out. Yeah, and this is sent to the Dropbox. And the microcontroller then gets the new parameter record, and the new parameter record is made by the adjust timer values. They are sent from the Dropbox to the Raspberry Pi, and are added there. The new starting number is then the 16 is incremented by 4, and the 5 then is the number of the day. Also, before it was June 5th, now it is June 6th, so there should be then a 6 there. And this number is again calculated as the time between the last record and the next midnight divided by 2 minutes. So can be another number, of course, and the last two numbers, they must be zero, so in the future maybe I will add some additional extensions to it. Okay, also this is the file that is now in the Dropbox, and as this content of the file is somehow a binary content, you cannot use it immediately for visualization, but I have to do some conversations of the file, and to do that I made a integrated development environment. It has 3.1 kilobytes, so it's not very big, but it consists mainly of a text widget and some buttons. With the buttons you can go forward and backward one page, and with the numbers here, when you mark them, the program switches to the file that has the same name, so it's like that the directory is, as you want, maybe is an electronic book, and the files are the pages in the book. And I use these files, or these scripts in these files to process the data. And maybe you remember two slides ago, I showed you the structure of this memory chip. And I have now to make the real currents in, current out, and voltage from that. Oh, this is not visible here. Strange. Ah, yeah, it moved somehow. So here stood 205, and here was 205 and 5. Ah, yeah. Yeah, this should be here, marked here. Also, so this is maybe the current out at that time. The time is calculated from the time was here, June 10th, 22 hours and so on. And so this is this individual number, and then so I calculate the time here, and the 5 and the 205 is then, for example, set the out current is set out, it's the expression of the integer of 5 times 256 plus 205, so these two numbers, then I divide it by 32768, this is the when you have a 16-bit analog digital converter, and it has also negative numbers, so 32,768 is the highest value, positive value that you can have. Then the voltage is 1.024 volts is the maximum value, and this is a coefficient number. I come soon to the end. Yes. So I convert that, and now finally I can, with this data, I can make a diagram. I have two diagrams. This one is the last 400 days. So green is energy in, energy out. And for every day, there where you have the pointer, you can move the pointer here by minus 80, minus and so on, and plus back and forth. You can get a diagram of the day also. Then you see from midnight when the Raspberry Pi is in during 2 minutes, it makes a little peak. Normally, during my sleep, I don't need a current, and then I have the laptop on, the smartphone on, I look television, so you see that, and when the sun is shining, the intensity also, and the black line is the energy. It starts at midnight always here, and then when I consume energy, it's going down, and when I gain energy, it's up, and then I lose energy again, and the result you can see in the top line. So that's then all, and thanks for listening. If you have some questions, yes. And maybe if we can make it also during the coffee break, or if we are very short.
Hi.
Also here has also a question.
I would be interested, how do you switch off the Raspberry via software?
I can show you. This is the circuit diagram. Also the ATtiny has one line. No, where is it? Here. Through a 1 mega ohm resistor, it switches a low signal transistor, which is connected to 12 volts. And normally when the Raspberry Pi is switched off, then this transistor switched on. So this has no effect. When this is switched off, then 12 volts are in the gate from the field effect transistor. And this has 5 volts here. This has 5 volts, and this is connected.
I'm not sure.
No, this is always connected to 5 volts, but when the transistor is switched on, it will be connected to ground, and so the whole thing is switched on.
you are switching it off by a relay?
No, by a field effect transistor. This is a Woods 10. Is
okay.
Also, it can switch up to 80 amperes, and when it is switched on, the resistance is 0.02 ohms only, so it's like a relay, but it is a transistor, not a relay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do you have a question also?
What do you do on Fridays?
On Fridays? I also look at my solar module. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. But it's really a big project, and I think I will continue also. It's 75 amperes. It is in the first slide, I mentioned that. So, no. Yeah. 75 ampere hours, yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I have maybe for 2-3 weeks I have enough energy, and in winter, of course, during between end of November and end of January, I only use very little energy. Yeah, the main energy I take from the mains, from normally 220 volt. Then.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank. Yeah.
Once the battery is full, how do you get rid of the excessive energy?
This is independent electronics. I have this has nothing to do with Tickle, but I have 2 lamps of 50 watts in serial. When the wire is cold in the lamp, it will take a current of maybe 10 amperes or so, and then here this is an operating amplifier which has a hysteresis, so when the voltage between the positive and negative input is a little bit higher, then it is switched on, and through the hysteresis, it will not immediately switch off when it is a little bit unequal, but it goes down maybe between 14.4 volts and 13.9 volts, and then when it is below that, then the lamps are switched off. When it is above, they are switched on. So there's sometimes a blinking of the lamps all the time. Then.
I would recommend ventilator because when it's most sun and most hot, ventilator, not a lamp.
Yeah, this would be an interesting effect also. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Thanks, Uli.
Yeah. Yeah. And during the coffee break, I can show how to program the chip if you are interested also.
And also during the coffee break, I've put up a flitch.